Well, I invite you to open your Bibles or turn on your smartphones to James chapter 2. We're going to be studying James chapter 2. And before we dive into it, I think it's good for us to read it so we can familiarize ourselves. James chapter 2, verse 14 to 26. James chapter 2, verse 14. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Verse 18. But someone will say, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. And he was called a friend of God. Verse 24. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. This is God's word. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we see so much in this biblical text, and we need you by your Holy Spirit to open our eyes. How much we desperately need you to peel back all the layers of worldliness and sin, all the layers of troubles and griefs and anxieties. Lord, I pray that you help us to see your word clearly as that which has been spoken to you from before the foundation of the world, that our hearts would be penetrated and then that Christ would teach us in our hearts and in our minds how to be more like him and less like the world. Thank you, Father, that you do this for your glory and for our good. Amen. So we're looking at James chapter 2, verse 14 to 26. And before we do that, it's good for us to review what we have done so far. We're in chapter 2, we're making headway. If you turn back just one page to James chapter 1, in the beginning we looked at verse 2 to 4, where that talks about the test of trials. We talk about the test of trials and how God uses trials to bring about his purposes in our lives and to bring us to maturity. And then we looked at the test of temptation. That was in verse 13 to 15. And we saw how temptation can be something that we overcome or something that overcomes us. And we saw there that God always provides a way of escape, that God always gives us an opportunity to turn away from our temptation. And then in verse 19 to 27 of chapter 1, we looked at the test of response to God's word. And if you all remember from that, James was saying very explicitly that it's not hearers of the word, it's not hearing the word that counts, it's doing the word, it's actively following and obeying God's word. So the test of response to God's word. And then, of course, we just finished a four-part series in James chapter 2, verse 1 to 13. And there we saw the test or the sin of partiality. And up until this point, James has been testing and has been pushing buttons and has been trying to orient us to real faith. So now in James chapter 2, verse 14 to 26, we see the test true faith, of real faith, the test of faith. Let's consider this morning, what is real faith? In particular, we'll be asking the question, what does real faith look like? What does real faith look like? What does James teach us that true faith looks like? I want to give the main point right at the beginning so that there's no confusion throughout the sermon, that faith without works is dead. Faith that is without works is dead. And real faith takes risks for others and follows God in obedience. That's the main point of the text of verse 14 to 26. Faith without works is dead. Real faith shows itself by risking itself in love for others and obeying God. So if you observe with me three times in this passage, verse 14 to 26, James reiterates the fact that faith without works is dead. In verse 17, you'll see that he writes, faith by itself, if it does not have works, it is dead. And notice in verse 20, do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? And then finally in verse 26, James writes, as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. And the question that James poses at the beginning of this passage will frame how the rest of this sermon will go. The question he asks is twofold. The first part of the question is, what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? And obviously the answer is, it's no good. There's no good in telling people you have faith if you have nothing to substantiate those claims, if you do not have works. So there's no good in that. And then the second part of the question is, can that faith save? Can that faith, namely the faith that is without works, can that faith save anybody? And obviously the answer is no. That faith cannot save. A faith that cannot be substantiated by work, by acts, by doing, cannot save. Now, this is the problem we must consider this morning, because increasingly in America, we notice a rapid movement towards secularization. That is a post-Christian view of the world. People are no longer submitting themselves and adhering to the values of Judeo-Christian beliefs. We are increasingly seeing that in the purview of our nation. Just to show you statistically that this is true, a group called the Barna Group, and many of you probably are familiar with this, is a research group that looks at Christian trends all throughout the 20th century and 21st century. They came up with a study, they researched, and they asked this question: how many American adults self-identify as Christians? And the number is 73% self-identify as Christians. You have the infograph there. 73% self-identify. This means that they say they are Christians, but now Barna did another follow-up research because they said, wait a minute, something's wrong with this claim, this self-identified Christian claim. In another study, they asked, of these self-identified Christians, how many of them attend church? So they said, a person who professes Christianity is defined this way, a self-identified Christian who attends a religious service at least once a month and says their faith is important to them. That's what it means to be a professing Christian. That's what was the case for the study. In that study, they found that 31% of all Americans are professing Christians. 31% of all Americans are professing Christians. They attend church once a week, and it's very important to them. Another way Barna measures religious decline in our culture is through something called the post-Christian metric. If an individual meets a certain amount, a certain percentage of a preset of factors, includes like disbelief in God, people who don't read their Bibles, people who don't go to church, they found that 50% of Americans are considered post-Christians. Now, what this means for us today, what this statement says, these research results show, is that talk is cheap. You can self-identify as a Christian and yet not be a professing Christian. Listen to the sobering conclusion that Barna states. Barna researchers argue this represents a more accurate picture of Christian faith in America, one that reflects the reality of a secularizing nation. Long gone are the days where self-identifying as a Christian actually meant that you were a practicing Christian. Long gone are those days. What these studies reveal is the clear disparity between people who just talk and people who act. Very relevant to our setting this morning, is it not? James is showing us that talk is cheap. What matters is what you do. Talk is cheap. What matters is what you do. So, again, can a faith that is without works, without any acting, can that faith save? No, it cannot. So this morning, we're going to see what kind of faith will save. This morning, we want to look at the beautiful contrasts that James puts forth, and he offers two starking contrasts. One of them relates to our relationship to others. One of them relates to our relationship to others, and the other relates to our relationship to God. One of them is to others, and one of them is to God. The first contrast is the contrast between the armchair Christian and Rahab the prostitute. This contrast reveals that talk is cheap, that real faith takes risks for others. And the second contrast is this, the contrast between demons and Abraham. Demons and Abraham. This contrast reveals that seeing is not believing. Seeing is not believing. Real faith follows God in unseen promises and obedience. Real faith will follow God in his unseen promises. So first, let's consider talk is cheap. Real faith risks itself for its neighbors. Consider the contrast. The first thing that James says is to describe the armchair Christian in verse 15 to 16. Listen what he says. He writes, "If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that?" The answer is, it's not good. You have not accomplished anything. Already, James is showing us how ridiculous it is to be an armchair Christian. And by armchair, I mean somebody who is always theoretical and up in the clouds with their thinking about God and others and never is able to reach the earth below so that it can catch traction. The armchair Christian always works from a posture of theory, never from practice. That's why I have labeled it the armchair Christian. Somebody who just sits there, you can imagine them in their armchair, and gives all of the truth claims and all of the principles, but never applies those truths and principles to their own lives. So for instance, look at the situation. There's a basic need. Somebody said, you know, somebody needs clothing and food. And what does the armchair Christian say to those basic needs? "Go in peace, be warmed and filled." And he doesn't provide the things needed for the body. This is the theoretical Christian. Are you a theoretical Christian? Things will be okay for you is what you tell your brothers and sisters. God will provide for you. But James is saying, yes, God will provide, but through you. My goal for my provision is that you would do it. I learned this lesson when I was young, and my grandmother was feeding birds, and I thought, why are you feeding birds? And she said, honey, God says the sparrows never go hungry, and I'm feeding them. He's using me to feed them. He's using me to not let them go into hunger. And it was so clear in my mind that God uses us for his purposes in the world, that God is using us to feed the hungry and clothe the naked. Jesus says, how many of you have fed me and how many of you have clothed me? That's what matters, that we have the opportunity to do these things. God is using us for his purposes. So the Christian faith is meant to bless the whole world. It's not meant to stand back in idle theory and just give ideas. It's meant to act. It's meant to be hands-on. It's supposed to offer food and clothing. Jesus says, if a person asks you for a tunic, give them all your clothes, preferably not at the same time. Go the extra mile. Sacrifice your needs. Give up your resources and time. Don't just think of all the amazing ways you can impact the world. Go and do it. Go and do it. Think it through. Go and do it. Words will not mean a thing unless they are accompanied by a life that is compelling. Words will not mean a thing to anybody unless we give a life that is compelling. A Puritan says of these verses, he says this, words are a cold kind of pity. The stomach is not filled with words, but meat. Nor is the back warmed with well wishes. Brothers and sisters, how readily could we be available to feed the hungry and clothe the naked? Here's the principle. This is what we have to get here. Faith is not primarily a matter of what I say. It's a matter of my action. Faith is a matter of what I do, not what I say. It is about how you act in light of your beliefs. Talk is cheap. Real faith is active. But moving on, we see the contrast to the armchair Christian. What's the contrast? Rahab, the prostitute. Rahab, the prostitute. She is the example that James offers. Don't be like the armchair Christian. Be like Rahab, the prostitute. But don't you find it strange, I certainly did, that James is telling you to emulate a woman who has a marred background? She's not somebody we would normally be ready to emulate. I mean, she was a prostitute. And James is saying, be like Rahab. Now, why would James use Rahab as an example of what real faith looks like? Real faith is not about being perfect. It's about being forgiven. Real faith is not about being perfect. It's about being forgiven. And unlike the armchair Christian whose faith was passive, Rahab acted. Rahab acted. So here's the principle we can draw out from Rahab's life. Real faith risks itself in love for its neighbors. Real faith risks itself in love for its neighbors. Consider Rahab's life. We recall the story from Joshua chapter 2. You don't have to turn there in your Bible. I'm just going to briefly summarize it. But I highly encourage you to go read. In Joshua chapter 2, Joshua sends two spies to scope out Jericho. He sends two spies, and these spies are supposed to scope out the land. Joshua is wanting to conquer the land, and these spies are meant to see the land. And so, he sends the spies, and the spies go to Rahab's house, and the king hears that there are spies at Rahab's house, and he sends men to go after those spies, to catch them, and to put them to death. And they show up at Rahab's door, and what does Rahab say? She says, I don't know, they came through, but they're long gone. Maybe you can catch them if you go right now. And so they leave, and the city gate closes. It's already past the curfew. It closes, and the spies, meanwhile, are on the roof of the place. I mean, they're hidden. Rahab hid them. So what happens? Rahab lets them go. She doesn't tell on them. But before she tells them to go, they're free. She asks them for mercy. She knows that God is going to judge the land. She knows her people are sinful. She knows that God is going to bring judgment. So the first thing she asks in faith is, please spare my life and my family's life just as I've spared your life. Remarkable faith. Remarkable faith for somebody who's never been part of God's people to make those claims of God. Listen to what she says. This is the first thing we learn about real faith. Real faith thinks. Listen to what Rahab says. In Joshua 2, it's on the screen in front of you. Listen to her words. I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land will melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. And there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. Pretty striking words for somebody who does not know God. To recognize first that God is in control of all of history. To recognize that God is sovereign over all the circumstances and over all peoples. And finally, to know that God is the creator over all things and he is just to judge for sin. So, Rahab asks in faith. She responds to God's character. She asks in faith. She responds. Real faith responds. You see it in verse 9 and in verse 12. In verse 12, she says to the spies, "Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will kindly deal with my father's house and give me a sure sign." Anybody else you want to add to that list, Rahab? "Yes, add my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death. Please spare us." And she's asking in faith. She knows who God is. She knows that she deserves God's wrath. And yet she asks for mercy. And what happens? It's incredible. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, we see the result of her faith. In verse 31, it says, "By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient. Because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies, she acted in faith. Everybody was spared." In fact, if you read the first chapter of Matthew, who is in Jesus' lineage? Rahab the prostitute. Incredible how God uses sinners, imperfect people, to accomplish his purposes in the world. And so finally, we see that real faith takes risk. Rahab took a great risk. She risked her life. She risked her family's life. She risked the life of the spies. Think about it. If Rahab was caught and the spies were killed, they would have never conquered the land. Rahab would have died, and the lineage would not have gone to Jesus. But God is sovereign over the course of history, is he not? Do we not see God's power and his authority in this story, that God uses these events, these simple events, to bring about his purposes? So she risked her life. She showed remarkable faith. And God saved her. God spared her. How can we apply these principles today, brothers and sisters? How can we have real faith that is active and real faith that takes risks for others? What would it be like for our church to have remarkable, authentic, true, real faith? What would it take to get there? What are some ways we can risk and give of ourselves and our resources? To help us answer those questions, to help us apply this text, we have to consider, why does James keep using the example of the needy and the poor in this letter? He did it twice in James 1. He did it in James chapter 2 at the very beginning, and he's doing it again. Why does he keep bringing up the poor and the needy? I think the first reason is the poor and needy are the very least able to pay us back. They reveal the true motives of our hearts. You want to see if your faith is real? Go and eat with a homeless person. I challenge you to go and spend time with a homeless person. They cannot give you anything back. They can only thank you. So it reveals your motives. Are you seeking something in return? Are you seeking to have your risk buffered by some sort of insurance? Risk has no limit. Risk leads to death. But the second reason why James keeps using the poor and the needy is to reveal whether we are being like God, whether we are truly acting like God. In James 2, verse 1 to 13, we saw that acting like God meant that we would be impartial. The armchair Christian says he's impartial, but treats people with the greatest level of partiality. The armchair Christian claims impartiality, but hates his neighbor. Rahab acted like God when the spies came. She showed impartiality. She showed a welcome, friendly greeting to these people. But serving the poor and needy is by no means by no means the only way we can demonstrate our real faith. Everybody in this room probably has a Facebook or a Twitter or an email account. Every single day, you are exposed to thousands of ways you can serve your neighbor just through social media. Every single day, you are exposed to thousands of opportunities to show and demonstrate your faith. Every single day. Think of your spheres of influence: mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, lawyers, doctors, employees, employers, business owners, teachers, students. Each of these aspects of your life pose the possibility of hundreds of ways you can risk your life for your neighbor. It doesn't have to be big things. It's the small things that lead to the big things. Risking your life, giving of your resources, giving of your time. So if you're rich in time, why not spend some of that time here at the church? Why not spend it serving brothers and sisters? If you're rich in resources, why not fund the next mission trip so that the gospels can go to the ends of the world? If you are rich in knowledge, why not use that knowledge to advance the purposes of God? The proclamation of the gospel is perhaps the most significant way we can demonstrate our real faith. By going to unreached, unengaged people groups and saying, you are a sinner, you need the gospel, God loves you. He gave his life through Jesus Christ for you. People need to hear that. And they're not going to hear it if we're armchair Christians. They're only going to hear it if we're like Rahab. They're only going to hear it if we go out to the ends of the world, because we are the types of people that risk our lives for the sake of the gospel. But consider also how this biblical text informs your decision in the upcoming election and your role in society. Think of all the needy and oppressed unborn children whose lives are taken this very moment by abortion. Think of all the people that just scoff at the death of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of babies. What can you do? What can you say? You can go and you can advocate. You can share the gospel. You can adopt. Real faith takes risks. If you are not willing to put your money where your mouth is in Christianity, it is going to be increasingly hard for you in our secularizing nation to demonstrate that you're a Christian. One day, it will be revealed that you are not, or that you are. And may God help us to be these types of Christians. So brothers and sisters, give of your resources, give of your time. Faith is active. Talk is cheap. Real faith loves its neighbors enough to take risks and share the gospel. Be like Rahab. Amen. That's the end of the sermon. I'm just kidding, because we have the second part, the second contrast. The second contrast. Let's continue to what James presents as the contrast that shows our relationship to God. Seeing is not believing. Real faith trusts in God's unseen promises. Let's first consider the demons. In verse 18, James writes, someone will say, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. As we mentioned above, merely saying that your faith is true, biblical faith is not enough. Real faith has evidence. Real faith has results. Real faith is active. But now James wants to know, what's the best way, apart from works, to prove that you have real faith? This is the situation in verses 18 and 19. We can imagine kind of like an imaginary conversation between James and one of the members of the congregation to whom he's writing. and someone in the congregation says, you have faith and I have works, and James challenges that, and he says, okay, show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. And that's a very difficult challenge, isn't it? To demonstrate your faith apart from your works, what else would you use? So the person says, okay, I can demonstrate that I have faith, but not by using works. Let me do it this way. I'm going to show you how much knowledge I have of God. So, being a good Jewish Christian in the church that James is writing to, he opens up to Deuteronomy 6, and he recites, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And James immediately interrupts him and says, okay, great, you believe that God is one, you believe the Lord is one, good job, that's good. But the demons believe that. And they shudder. And almost immediately the conversation ends, because James can show how every single Christian belief we hold to is better known, better understood, and better recited by demons. Just for instance, say, you know, Christians believe for centuries that Jesus is God. We believe that. That's an orthodox view of ours. It's a true view. It's a normal, it's a natural view of Christianity. Jesus is God. Just by reading the Gospels and outlining what the demons say in the Gospels, you'll get that Jesus is holy, Jesus is God, and Jesus is powerful from the mouths of demons. So, James says, it's not enough to know that. It's not enough to say that. It's not enough to believe that. Why? Because the demons know that, and they hate God. Demons have PhDs in theology. Demons have studied under the greatest teacher in the universe, God. They've had centuries to devise all sorts of theological propositions, ideas, principles. They've studied the biblical text more than you have and more than I have. They've learned Greek. They've learned Hebrew. They've even preached. They even go to the ends of the world and bring the false gospel. So to say that I'm safe because I believe Jesus is God, James says, you have the faith of a demon. There's nothing there to substantiate your faith. Because faith that demons have leads only to fear and trembling, not worship and praise. Real faith always leads to an honoring of God and a right place of God as the most valuable person in the universe. Demons have PhDs in theology, but they hate the subject. So the principle here is that real faith does not leave us to fear and trembling. Real faith leads us to trust and obedience. Is your faith similar to a faith of a demon? Or, as James presents the contrast, the faith of Abraham? Do you have the faith of Abraham? Abraham, who is considered the friend of God. James writes in verse 21 of Abraham, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works, and the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Now, if you want to look at Abraham's life, it's from Genesis 12 to Genesis 22. We're not going to read that whole thing. But go home and read that and be encouraged in your faith, brothers and sisters. Genesis 12 to 22. God comes to Abraham and he promises to Abraham, Abraham, I will give you an offspring that is as countless as the stars in the sky and sand on the seashore. All you have to do is follow me. Believe me. So Abraham says, let's go. Where are we going? I'm good. I'm down. Let's go. And because of that, in Genesis 15, verse 6, we read that Abraham believed the Lord, the promises of God, that God would make him a father of many nations, a father of many offspring. He believed the Lord, and the Lord counted it to him as righteous. Right off the start of Abraham's life, he is justified before God. He's going to heaven because he believed. But wait a minute. Abraham is like in his 70s. And Abraham knows biology, and he knows, wait, my wife can't have kids. We're too old. Wait, how's God going to do this? So Abraham doesn't believe in God's promise and gets together with Sarah's servant, Hagar, and they have a child named Ishmael. And Abraham's like, this is the son. This is the son who I'm going to have my nations through. This is the son that God is going to bless me through. And God shows up and he says, no, I told you to wait. I told you that was going to be through Sarah. And it's almost funny. It's almost hilarious. Sarah, you know, you read in the text, Sarah's laughing. She's like, there's no way. This is impossible. But then Sarah gets pregnant and she has Isaac. And Isaac is the blessing that God is going to bless, through whom God is going to bless Abraham. So you're tracking with that? God fulfilled his promise, and Isaac is the one. Isaac is the money. So in Genesis 22, it's shocking then to read this in verse 1. After these things, these events, after Isaac was born, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abram. And he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, you know, rubs it in three times, you know, take your son, your only son, whom you love, and take him and offer him as a sacrifice. Go to the land of Moriah and offer him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. Now, at this point, you're thinking, no, I'm not going to do it. Abraham's not going to do it. I mean, he waited 30 years to have a child, and it's been comical and unbelievable, and it happened. Of course, I'm going to protect my job. I'm going to shield my helicopter parent, Abraham, right? Verse 3 says, listen to what verse 3 says. Abraham rose early in the morning. Listen to how intentional this is. He rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac, and he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place God told him to go to. He didn't even question. He said, I'm going to go. God said it. I'm going to go. In verse 9 of chapter 22, we read that when they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid wood in blocks and arrangements. Very intentional. And bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. This is the most awkward encounter in the Bible. Could you imagine, you know, hey, Abraham, Isaac, I have to tie you up. Don't ask why, I just got to do it, okay? I mean, what's that interaction like? I would never bind up my child, would you? And Abraham does it because God told him to do it. And then in verse 12, we read, as Abraham is standing over the altar ready to kill his son Isaac, we read this. The angel of the Lord said to Abraham, do not lay your hand on your son, on the boy, or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And then in verse 16, the Lord says, by myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of the heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore, and your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. What remarkable faith. Why did Abraham unreluctantly bind Isaac to kill him on the altar? Why? Hebrews 11 gives us the answer why. It's remarkable. Verse 17, by faith, Hebrews 11, verse 17, by faith, Abraham, when tested, offered up Isaac, And he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, through Isaac shall your offspring be named. Verse 19, he considered that God was able even to raise Isaac from the dead. From which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. So you can almost see Abraham like, man, I could have witnessed the first resurrection. That's why I acted unreluctantly. That's why I was so willing to go, because I knew, I banked on the fact that my God is a God of life, not death. And he promised. He said, I'm going to bless you through this son. God is not a liar. I believe him. So Abraham believed the resurrection. That's why he was so willing to offer up his son. How do you obey God when it is costly? How do you obey God when it is costly? When God's call for your life is obedience to him, and it costs you everything. When God calls us to give all that we have, when we'd rather be rich and fill our IRA accounts. Or when God's call is for singleness on your life, when you'd rather be married. Or when God's call for your marriage is to remain as husband and wife when you'd rather be divorced. Or when God's call is for purity when you'd rather lust. When God's call is for sobriety when you'd rather drink. Or when God calls you to be a peacemaker but you'd rather vent your frustration and gossip. What do you do then when it is costly? Abraham, be like Abraham. James says, be like Abraham, who is a friend of God. An incredible, just a remarkable man who lived in the 1800s, George Mueller, was a pastor in England for 66 years in the same church. George Mueller had incredible faith. He had remarkable faith. He had real faith. He had the type of faith that Rahab and Abraham possessed. He risked his well-being for others, literally. And he trusted in God's goodness and provision like no other before him or after him. George Mueller is known for building orphanages in England. He built 5 large orphan houses and cared for over 10,000 orphans in his lifetime. When he started in 1834, there were only accommodations for 3,600 orphans in all of England, and most of those kids were in prison. One of the great effects of Mueller's ministry was to inspire others, and he did, so much so that 50 years after Mueller began his work, at least 100,000 orphans were cared for in England alone. 100,000. He prayed in millions of dollars. He prayed in millions of dollars without ever asking for money from anybody. He never took a salary in the last 68 years of his ministry, but trusted that God would put it in people's hearts to send him what he needed. He never took out a loan or went into debt, and neither he nor his orphans were ever hungry. That's financial independence. George Mueller had real faith. Several times throughout his life, he had written that the purpose of opening these orphanages was to live a life and lead a ministry in such a way that God proves to be real, that God is trustworthy, and that God answers prayer in faith. He built orphanages the way he did to help Christians see how remarkable God is and how trust and obedience will bring blessing in one's life. Friends, this is the test of real faith. How do you relate to God and others? Are you willing to sacrifice and offer everything you have to risk your life for others? Are you trusting and relying on God's unseen promises to carry you through? Friends, in closing, I want us to consider Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of real faith. How did he relate to us? How did Jesus relate to you and me? While we were enemies, Christ gave up his life for his neighbor. And how did he relate to God? Christ obeyed God, even though it meant that it would lead him to death. Death on a cross. Christ was nailed to a wooden cross and offered himself in our place as a substitute, as a sacrifice for our sin. The wrath that we deserve, the punishment we deserve because of our sinfulness, Jesus took upon himself in joy and gladness because he was risking his life for his neighbor. He knew he had to die, and he did not abandon his calling. He knew he had to suffer well, and that the only way he would suffer well is through obedience, in obedience to God. Jesus practiced real faith, and he gave his life in such a way that God, because of his real faith, raised him from the dead to prove that my sin and your sin is taken care of. And so, what does God want most from us? What does God desire most from us today? He wants us to repent from our sin, and he wants us to trust in him. He wants us to repent and to trust. If you are not a Christian, friend, if you are not a Christian, consider that the only meaningful life, the only meaningful faith you will ever have is found by trusting Christ. Consider, friend, that the only satisfaction and the only joy and fulfillment that you can have from anything spiritual is by risking your life for others and by obeying God in faith. Brothers and sisters, if you're here this morning and you've been challenged, I pray that our congregation would be more and more marked by a life willing to risk itself and a life of obedience to God. I pray that we would be more like Rahab and Abraham, that we would be active in our faith, that we would fight for joy, that we would go to the ends of the world, that we would proclaim the gospel in faith, and that our faith would be demonstrated by willingness to sacrifice for others and to be obedient to God. Let's pray.